with our next comedian, who is probably going to have you rolling in the aisles just like Justice. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Ella Zumbach. Happy to be here.
You guys are smiling.
Okay, so I'm gonna start by talking about how I had like the wildest imagination. And some of you in the audience are probably like, no, I have the wildest imagination. Well, I have you beat. I don't know like where I saw it, but I have this very strange pet peeve of one-piece swimsuits and tennis shoes. And you know, I'm not talking your average one-piece swimsuit, your average tennis shoes. Very specific. So I'm imagining this woman in a one-piece swimsuit. It's one of those Speedo ones. It's also like from the 80s, so it goes all the way up. And she's chilling. She's running, slow running on the beach. You see her blonde hair just bouncing. She's got her scrunchy high ponytail. The bangs that go all the way out and all the way back in. And she's got these tennis shoes. Now, you know, you're thinking just like average tennis shoes, like maybe the ones I have. No, they're like the ugliest Asics you've ever seen. And then she's got these socks. The white socks that your mom used to make you wear at church. They got a little lace on them. They got little holes. Yeah, it's horrible. She's killing it. So that's my imagination. So naturally, my dreams are going to be super weird. And one of the nightmares, actually, that I had was when the Club Penguin Penguins, you know, the cartoon ones, all the memes, they captured my family, hung them up in the big fish nets, and hung them in a Costco. So that happened. And, you know, one of my dreams, and not like my dream, like one of my aspirations in life, when I was a child, I just thought this was the coolest job in the history of jobs. And I thought it would be the coolest if you were a manager at PetSmart. So there's actually evidence of this. My mom has it, she's in the back. Hi, Mom. And she showed me this picture, and it's this little picture of me. There's like this cartoon outline of an astronaut, but I like crossed it out. There's like a little name tag that says LZ PetSmart. But yeah, so that happened. But you know, I'm pretty close to my childhood dream, actually. Very close. I work at Jimmy John's now. So, woot woot. Yeah, I love my job. It's a great job. My boss, he's super cool. You know, he's like, super cool dude, best friends. But who is not my best friend is this kid that comes in. He comes in once, like in the history of my time at Jimmy John's. Comes in once. He's from here. I don't know his name, but comes in and he gets a sandwich. He's like, hide behind his desk. And he walks out, gets a regular sandwich. I'm like, okay. But now every time I see him, which is every day, he looks at me every time in the hallway. He's like, Jimmy John's. Like, yeah! So, that happened. And, you know, I was a weird kid myself. Like, I can't really blame it. One of my favorite childhood stories is when I just hated clothes. I just, like, didn't think they should be a thing, like, ever. So I walked around naked all the time. And once I started going to school, my mom's like, okay, you gotta wear clothes. But I would slowly take them off. The day. So my mom had to start dressing me in layers. But this one weekend, there was a weekend, so I'm like chilling, naked, living the dream. And my oldest sister Hannah and her friend Kaylee are babysitting me. So you know, those party. And you know, I wake up at like 6 in the morning, and I'm like, I want to go play outside. So I have no clothes on. I'm sprinting. I go outside. It's fun. I have the best time of my life outside. My knees are green, my elbows are green. I probably have some weird stuff on my face. And Kaylee wakes up, the friend. This like 8 by now, so I've been outside for a long time. And she's like, all right, where are the girls? Where's Ella? She goes to my room, doesn't find me. searches the entire house and can't find me still. So she wakes up my sister and she's like, Hannah, I can't find Ella. Hannah's like a rough sleeper, like deep sleep. She had to do it like 3 or 4 more times. Hannah! So then they finally like go out to the backyard. I'm not there. And then they run out to the front yard and they see me like dancing in the street. Like naked. Like, all right, I'm tired. This is snack time, right? PJ, cross cut off. Not what I like. They look at me and they're like, where have you been? I'm like, oh, I've just been outside. Just outside. And they're like, Ellie, you know there's a street there, right? I was like, yeah, that's what makes it more fun. But yeah, so that's fun. But that also comes from my honky family. And some of you may know me. I live from Sheridan. It's a fun place. You may have heard about it on the news. Called Obama a lying monkey, so that's also fun. Yeah, so live in the country, love my family. My dad goes hunting because, you know, we're from the country. And every year, he brings back the meat, and we eat it, and it's fun. But the one thing that he saves, you'll never guess. You know, you see those heads of deers, they're like in the offices, big badass corporate guys, like, got a deer in my office. Yeah, we don't have that. My dad just keeps the horns, and they're not for decoration, like you see on Pinterest and things, where they're like covered in gold. No, they're hung up on my door as a towel hook. Great thing, really should try it. But another thing that I love about being from the country is my dream truck. A lot of you guys might have, you know, like Rolls Royce, maybe brand new Chevy, whipping in, like that's a fast car, so many miles on it. You know, gas mileage is awesome. Yeah, right, it's not gonna be awesome. Because I want this 80s truck. It's like, got the big wheels, it's got rust on the like wheel rims, it's orange and blue, it's got the dome clearance lights that really have no purpose. You can hear it from like a mile away, it's just like so yeah, that's fun. But something else that I do in my free time, and mostly in my childhood, was I play sports. I'm actually repping today, so repping. Something that I do is sports. Fine. I love my team. I love all my teams, but I'm not good at them. I'm not good at sports. You want to know why? Because of my knees. I've actually torn my ACL 3 times. Those of you that don't know, it's a great icebreaker, actually. Tell me something about yourself. Most people go, you know, my favorite color is like turquoise, so I'm like super, like, you know, hipster, and like nobody has the favorite color turquoise. Yeah, I got ACLs. And I'm going to tell you guys all 3 times, because they're hilarious, all of them. And the first time, I went skiing with my friends, Muriel and Maya, and, you know, it was great. I'd never been skiing before, so I was super excited. And, you know, I was there for like an hour, maybe. And my friend Maya looks at me, she's like, hey, you want to go on the blue diamond? Like, I don't know what that is, but yes. That, like, just got to pass. Like the pizza french fry stage. So we're like on the lift, I'm ready. I'm like, yeah. We get there, and this is right after lunch, so you know I had to like take the skis off. And something that not a lot of people know is that skis have like these emergency brake thingies that like go like this at the bottom of the ski. Didn't know those were a thing. And I grabbed not my skis, so the emergency brakes were on. And you know, it's only on my left one that the emergency brakes are on. But you know, of course, I did not know this. So I'm going there, the ski lift's coming up. I'm like, yeah. Maya's like, okay, we're gonna go hard right. So you gotta put all your weight on your left leg, and then we're gonna turn. I'm like, all right, I got this. Put all my weight on my left, and the rest of my body just goes. And let me tell you, I have never seen a grown man laugh harder at a small child. Like hill where the like emergency ski guy was like, oh god, I have to get this little boat. It's called a toboggan or something. You know, I'm sitting there, I'm like laying there, just shards and glass in my eyes. Is it snow? So I didn't know. And then that was fun. Story number two is kind of like a combo can. I was playing basketball, typical, and this girl at the deaf school, just, you know, deaf school is known for like aggression, and they say it's because when you lose one of your senses, the other one is heightened. And you know, people tell me that aggression isn't a sense, but those people haven't been to the deaf school. This girl, she comes at me. I'm like chilling at the opposite end of the court here. Ball's over there. I'm chilling. I'm like ready to go. Just pass me the ball, whatever. This girl, she's a linebacker. And she just comes and swoops me. And I'm on the ground. It's over. And then the next time, like, combo can situation is March Madness. You know, I'm playing. I'm living life. It's March Madness. It's like 1 in the morning. And go up. And it's just, it's over. That's time number two. It's not very dramatic. So very emotional. But time number three, this has to be my favorite. Because it was after school. It was like 6 o'clock and my dad like still wasn't there. And I was like, kidding. So you know, naturally what happens at Blackwell after school, after 6 o'clock, is these guys are, they're like 25, they have nothing to do, they're all definitely single, and they have 5 people. And you know, the guy, Asher, that was with me, he had just left. So I was like, this is nice, it's just me and 5 dudes. And they look at me and they're like, hey, we're one person short, you wanna play some ball? I was like, yeah, I'm like not very good. They're like, oh, we don't care. It'll be fun. Yeah. And they divide teams. You know, I'm a post player, sort of. So I'm like relatively tall, relatively large. And they got this other guy who is not relatively large or tall. He is very large and very tall. It's like 3 times my height, 3 times my width. And I'm like, all right, I can take him. So the guy on my team shoots. I go for it. He also goes for it. We both jump, and I'm like, I got it! And then I feel this like weird blubber on my body. And what I did not know was that that was his stomach. The blubber was also sweaty. So I fall to the ground, and I'm like, ah! God damn. It's cool. You know, I think my dad's gonna be here soon. Fine. Sitting there for 20 more minutes until my dad gets here. But yeah. So that's it.
Stories of hers. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Grace Ibarra.
So, my life is gripped with a lot of fear. Not quite to the extent where I'm that lizard that sits alone in my basement, afraid to go outside because of Zika. But like, that's not that far off. I organize my fears in a sense to make them more meaningful because they're kind of extensive. I have my really mainstream fears, and these are like heights, the dark, spiders, public speaking. I'm just kidding. No, my biggest fear is actually needles. I am almost an adult, and I am still deathly afraid of going to the doctor's office. I hate shots. I still make my mom put my hand when I get a shot. And the sparkling fantasy gimme doesn't make it better. And well aware of. And my lovely sister has become aware of this as well from a very young age and has used it against me. One time my cousin and I were like giving her hell about something, we were teasing her about some boys, and she had just had enough of it. She was getting so pissed off. As she turned and she looked at me, she goes, "Do not make me say the N-word." It's like I can't escape needles, especially at family functions. The worst is Thanksgiving. You'd think that there wouldn't be needles at Thanksgiving, but my Aunt Sally proves otherwise. She shows up with a Ziploc baggie full of needles. Flu shots. And I assume this is to be like cost and time effective and vaccinating my entire family, but I don't get how this is like ethically okay. I guess the only justification is my family is originally from Kentucky. But this means that I spent my entire Thanksgiving in the basement, hiding under the pool table, hoping my mom doesn't find me and make me get my shot. And one year, I successfully hide the entire time, nobody finds me, I escape. Great. Yeah, I didn't know that my mom had another plan. So I spent the night at my Aunt Sally's house. And she came in the middle of the night while I am sleeping and sneak attacked me like some ninja and stabbed me in the arm with this flu shot. And I'm like a really heavy sleeper, so I didn't notice. But like, I'm still offended. Like, it still bugs me, and it scares me after the fact. It didn't scare me in the moment, but it does now. And like, Mom, you know consent is a thing, right? But I also have some other weird fears. I'm scared of having the windows like all the way rolled down in the car because I don't want something or someone, including myself, to fly out of the vehicle. I took physics, like I know this is impossible, but I don't know why I'm scared of that. Like that's the reason I wear my seatbelt. Not because I'm afraid of falling out in a collision, but because I'm afraid of flying out through the window. Convertibles are fine, actually. I love convertibles. Do not ask me how that's not the same thing. But my most ridiculous fear of all has to be my fear of getting in trouble. It's kind of weird. It's a fear I believe my parents instilled in me from a very young age through an amazing technique I love called parenting. And my plan of action to combat this fear was to essentially not get in trouble. So I was a really meticulous rule follower. And this plan worked until Spanish class in fourth grade when I was falsely accused of talking during silent reading time. And as every ISI elementary school teacher does, they have this behavioral chart, which is a stoplight. And it's got the red circle, the yellow circle, and the green circle. And everyone has their names on like a pretty little clothespin, and everyone starts up on green. I have spent my entire life on green up until this very moment. So I see her moving it from green to yellow, and I just see like my entire reputation like crumbling around me. It's the most upsetting moment of my life. And once I get in trouble, I go into this period of reflection like after it. And I'm like trying to bargain with myself, and I'm like thinking of every wrong decision I've ever made in my entire life, and rethinking my existence. And to make it worse, that day, not only was I shocked, but so was the entire school. It was the talk of the school, faculty, students, everyone was saying, "Oh my God, did you hear Grace got put on yellow?" Are you serious? I mean, I've moved on since then, through a lot of tears, passage of time, lots of counseling, but I'm good now, and I've managed to stay out of trouble for the most part. Up until recently, I took a trip to Disney World, like a month ago, and it was about to start raining, thunderstorming, and it's Florida, so basically it's like coming up Hurricane Katrina. And my hair doesn't do very well in the rain, so I was like, gotta get out of there. So my sister and I literally hightail it out of Disney World as fast as we can. We are mall walking. We look like your local 80-year-olds running as fast as we can but still trying to be respectful. And we make it to the parking lot. And I'm not sure if you guys are familiar, but Disney World is huge, which means the parking lot is bigger. So you have to take a vehicle to get to your vehicle. So we have to wait for this tram thing, and luckily the tram is right there. So we're gonna like escape this ray, great. But there's this fence that stands in the way. And I see no way around it. And I'm like, dang it, I see safety on the other side and I can't get over to it. So I'm like analyzing this fence, trying to figure out how to get around it, where's the nearest exit? And I'm like going through this plan in my head, And then I look up and I see my sister is already over the fence and in the train. So I see that there was this like small area where I could just step over it. So step over the fence in the tram. And like this wasn't that bad, but for some reason it made me feel really bad. Like I was really proud of myself for breaking something. Like I didn't use the right exit. Go me. So I'm sitting in the tram all proud of myself. And then up marches this fat tourist guy. He's like wearing the Jimmy Buffett shirt. And there's like Jesus sandals with socks and black carpet pants. And he whips out this badge. And it is a police badge, but let me tell you, this badge depicts the face of the beloved Mickey Mouse. And he proceeds to scold us for going over this fence. Like, I thought this was Disney World, not East Berlin. And he told us that first, it was dangerous for two reasons. First, it was dangerous because we looked suspicious. I was trying to escape. How does that look suspicious? Secondly, because we could have hurt ourselves. Are you kidding me? So, after he got the cuffs out and we talked ourselves out of it, he threatened to take us to Mickey Mouse jail. I don't know how we got out of it, it was probably my sister. He walks back to his Checkpoint Charlie post ready to gun down some more escaping tourists. And then we take the tram ride back to the car. It's a long tram ride, big parking lot. And in that time, I am sitting there in the tram, rethinking every decision I have ever made in my life, every bad moment. I see my teacher's hand taking my clothespin from green to yellow, like PTSD flashbacks. Why am I on this earth if I'm going to make these horrible mistakes? My parents are going to hate me for forever. And then I look over and I realize that I am the only person sitting in this tram. Everyone has gotten off. And my sister is sitting there looking at me like, Grace, are you really still upset? He freaking had Mickey Mouse on his badge. Thank you.
Lower it because our next comic is the same size as Quinn. Possibly taller, I'm not sure. Ladies and gentlemen, our final comic of the afternoon, so last but certainly not least, Miss Tendula Tellis.
Tendula! You look like a burnt biscuit.
Hi guys. As Asha said, I'm Tendula Tellis. I'm 15. I'm 6 feet tall. Yes, I know I'm tall. Yes, I play basketball. And yes, the weather's fine up here. Actually, being tall runs in my family. It's very genetic. You might see my brother. He's about 6'2", 13 years old. Kind of looks like a paintbrush. You also might have seen my mother. She's an African woman, about 5'10". She gets ridiculed about it every day. She's the shortest in our family now. And we have my dad, who's about 6'7". But you know, my family is actually really diverse. We're a really cool family. My mom, she's from Africa. She's from the Congo. And my dad, well, he's from Southern Indiana. So one thing I absolutely love about my family is Christmas time. Christmas time with the Tellises is quite interesting, to say the least. We have a tradition, so New Year's Eve, we go down to my white family in Southern Indiana, and then New Year's Day, we go to my black family just down the road. So Southern Indiana, the city that we go to is about 3 hours away, so we gotta pack the car, and that takes forever. And then we finally get there, and it's the beautiful, most beautiful sight you've ever seen. A beautiful, shiny, tin can trailer with all of the Christmas ornaments on the lawn, all the lawn gnomes, all of the lawn chairs. And you know, after my parents got married, they got a black Santa, so I was so proud of them. My mom, you know, being from Africa, she has to be like very traditional, very strict. So you have to say hello to all of your relatives, or else you are a shame on the family, and you are ridiculous. So I have to say hi to everyone there. Because, you know, we're the most late people. We are black. We're late. So I say hi. I'm like, hi, Jessica. Hi, Matthew. Hi, Mark. Hi, George. And all the Duggars that are there. Me and my cousins, we get into 3 conflicts every single Christmas. The first is who gets the most mac and cheese. The second is, it's kind of interesting, but we have these Christmas hats, and as we're the youngest in the family, we have to deliver the presents. So each of us are supposed to wear a Christmas hat while we deliver the presents. There's 6 elf ones and 1 unlucky Santa one. It's unlucky because all of my white cousins who have had it have also had lice, which I know goes with my eyesight because we're a white school. The issue with this is that we play games, and whoever loses has to wear the hat. And unfortunately, one year my brother lost, and you know, his hair. And he, when you know when you get lice, you have to cut your hair, and then it helps with like the shampooing and everything. He refused to wear the hat to the point where he was crying and screaming, and it was embarrassing because it was like last year, he was 13. And I was like, please stop doing that. He's such an embarrassment, I swear. And another thing, see, Kalehu values his hair more than he values my life. And one year, my cousin Matthew, he was just combing through his hair. Like he was in a trance, and he just kept combing and combing. We're like, Matthew, what are you doing? He's like, I don't know. It just keeps going. And my Uncle Timothy, he goes up, and he's Matthew's dad. So he goes, ha, my son's gay. They're very much Trump supporters. So the third conflict is the biggest issue that we have. With all 7,000 of us, there's one bathroom. And when Mama makes her refried greens, you want to be in the bathroom. And one unfortunate year, my dad got to the bathroom first. And let me tell you, every single bomb that could have gone off went off. It was like Afghanistan after that, so we weren't going in there. We were done. We had to wait till we went home after 3 hours. So, you know, the rest of the time we finished opening our presents, we finished watching football game, and we went home only to realize we forgot to lay. And we had to drive all the way back for 3 hours, and we had to drive back home. And then the next day was Christmas, and we love Christmas. It's the best day. We got all the presents. Except for the fact that we have to go visit my black family. Now, my black family is very interesting. I mean, when we get there, of course, we have to greet the relatives. Like, the white family is not, we're not racist like that. So we have to say hi to Mujinga, Bindila, Sharkeesha, Martin Luther, Beyonce, Obama. All of them are there. And we get there, and you know, everything on that side of the family is a competition for some reason. No one knows why, it just is. So who made the best salad that year? Who has the best accomplishments? And then who's the cutest baby? But there's only one baby, so we're kind of confused. And I mean, I always win. I'm always the cutest, of course. Another thing is, you know, like when you get to your grandma's house and she has that great home cooking. Well, my grandma makes rice and beans, and rice and beans. Okay, that's okay. Still love you. By far, my favorite part of Christmas is my Uncle Chibuka, but we call him Joe. He has this thing we like to call Joe CD. Joe CD is when he can spot a tiny speck of dust anywhere in the room. You don't know it's there, but he does. So when you have Joe CD, you might see symptoms like this. When my cousin used to go here, it's happened here, at church especially, that's the most fun. Another thing that's wrong with Josie is when we're opening presents. You know how fun it is to get that beautiful present and then you get to open the wrapping, like tear it up, and there's wrapping paper flying everywhere, and you get to throw the box and you finally have your present? Not with us. With us, you get your present, you take the tape off very carefully and set it aside. You unfold the wrapping paper, you take the box out, take the present, put the box back, put the wrapping paper back, put the tape back on, and throw it away. That makes opening presents quite a while. It lasts until about New Year's, but you know, we enjoy ourselves. And then the last thing, as I said, we are competitive. We play apples to apples, and instead of playing to the dead like normal people do, we play for our grandma's love, and you know, I always win, just like everything. So then, you know, it's the end of the day, we're just exhausted. It's probably like 2 in the morning because we're black and we have parties like that. And my mom is like dead asleep. This woman, I love you, Mom. But this woman can fall asleep anywhere, anytime, and just be passed out. And I'm always in charge of getting everyone home. So, I don't know if you guys have been in this, like, Steve Irwin situation, when you have to poke a grizzly bear that's asleep, but it's not a fun situation. My mom, when you wake her up, you gotta go, Marianne, can you wake up? And then when you wake up and her eyes roll to the back of your head, you better run to the car. That's right, she'll be sprinting after you, just listen. And then you gotta jump in the car, you're on your way home, and then you figure out Kalei's not there. Thank you.